The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Welcome on this seventh Sunday of Easter. You're welcome to sing along and join in or hum along with the hymns that we're singing today. I will announce them. You can find these hymns through on our website. On the left-hand corner, there's worship service videos on the left-hand side of the website, christwaterloo.ca. So that's our website. Go to it and then click on worship service videos, and that should lead you to where the hymns for today are found. And so you can sing along with the notes and the words. We remember that this house of worship, and where many of us live and work and play, sits on the traditional land of the Neutral, the Anishinaabe, and the Haudenosaunee peoples who've cared for this land for thousands of years. As we pray together today, may our vision of God's unifying presence be enlarged to consider all the people and all of creation whom God loves and cherishes. We sing together, "Blessed Be the Tie That Binds," number 656. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And also with you.
Let us pray. God of renewal and transformation, you call us to be one with you as you are one with Christ. As his perfect love casts out our fear, and changes it to love. Unite us by your Spirit of peace, that we may be one with you as you are one with Christ. Amen.
A reading from the fourth chapter of 1 Peter. Beloved, do not be surprised at the fiery ordeal that is taking place among you to test you, as though something strange were happening to you. But rejoice insofar as you are sharing Christ's sufferings, so that you may also be glad and shout for joy when his glory is revealed. If you are reviled for the name of Christ, you are blessed, because the Spirit of glory, which is the Spirit of God, is resting on you. Humble yourselves, therefore, under the mighty hand of God, so that he may exalt you in due time. Cast all your anxiety on him, because he cares for you. Discipline yourselves. Keep alert. Like a roaring lion, your adversary, the devil, prowls around, looking for someone to devour. Resist him, steadfast in your faith, for you know that your brothers and sisters in all the world are undergoing the same kinds of suffering. And after you have suffered for a little while, the God of grace, who has called you to his eternal glory in Christ, will himself restore, support, strengthen, and establish you. To him be the power forever and ever. Amen. We will read responsively the Psalm 68. Let God arise, and let God's enemies be scattered. Let those who hate God flee.
As smoke is driven away, so you should drive them away. As the wax melts before the fire, so let the wicked perish at the presence of God.
But let the righteous be glad and rejoice before God. Let them also be merry and joyful.
Sing to God. Sing praises to God's name. Exalt the one who rides the clouds. I am is the name. Rejoice before God.
In your holy habitation, O God, you are a father to orphans, defender of widows.
You give the solitary a home and bring forth prisoners into freedom. But the rebels shall live in desert places.
O God, when you went forth before your people, when you marched through the wilderness, the earth quaked and the skies poured down rain at the presence of God, the God of Sinai, at the presence of God, the God of Israel. You sent a bountiful rain, O God. You restored your inheritance when it languished.
Your people found their home in it. In your goodness, O God, you have made provision for the poor.
Sing to God, O kingdoms of the earth. Sing praises to the Lord.
You ride in the heavens, O God, in the ancient heavens. You send forth your voice, your mighty voice.
Ascribe power to God, whose majesty is over Israel, whose strength is in the skies.
How wonderful you are in your holy places, O God of Israel, giving strength and power to your people. Blessed be God. And the gospel reading from the Gospel of John, chapter 17. Glory to you, O Lord. After Jesus had spoken these words to his disciples, he looked up to heaven and said, Father, the hour has come. Glorify your Son, so that the Son may glorify you. Since you have given him authority over all people to give eternal life to all whom you have given him, and this is eternal life, that they may know you, the only true God, and Jesus Christ, whom you have sent. I glorified you on earth by finishing the work that you gave me to do. So now, Father, glorify me in your own presence with the glory that I had in your presence before the world existed. I have made your name known to those whom you gave me from the world. They were yours, and you gave them to me, and they have kept your word. Now they know that everything you have given me is from you, for the words that you gave me I have given to them, and they have received them, and they know in truth that I came from you, and they have believed that you sent me. I am asking on their behalf. I'm not asking on behalf of the world, but on behalf of those whom you gave me, because they are yours. All mine are yours, and yours are mine, and I have been glorified in them. And now I am no longer in the world, but they are in the world, and I am coming to you. Holy Father, protect them in your name that you have given me, so that they may be one, as we are one. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
Jesus, here in chapter 17 of the Gospel of John, prays for his disciples. And essentially, he prays that they may be one, that they may know their unity in God and in each other, their oneness. God in Jesus, Jesus in God, and God in them. All mine are yours, O God, Jesus prays, and yours are mine, and I have been glorified in them, that is, the disciples. God, Jesus, disciples, unified, dwelling in each other. The dividing line between the sacred and the material world, or the non-sacred world, has forever been broken down. And in everyone, the divine, the human, dwell in each other, are unified and connected in one. And then Jesus caps this passage off with his words in verse 11. He prays, Holy God, protect them in your name that you have given me, so that they, as in his disciples, may be one as we are one, that the disciples may be one. 14th century mystic Julian of Norwich experienced being at one with God through her many visions and mystical encounters and dreams that we can read about in her writings that you can access online. She described this divine union as oneing, oneing. That's an interesting term, oneing. She means that through all of life, with all of life's joys and sorrows and happiness and hardships, we aren't alone, that we can be oneing with God or at one with the Holy, even as we travel along the journey of life, oneing in God. I think it's easy to imagine or kind of accept the proposition that some sort of oneness with God can be experienced at the personal level, at that level of interiority, deep in the heart, at the gut level. But what about oneness or oneing with others? The second part of Jesus' prayer, the experience of unity with others as a people of God, what might that look like or feel like? It might be a lot harder to imagine or accept or envision, since so much about the history of Christianity and even the current status of the church in the world seems so fraught with division and acrimony and even violence, the 30 Years' War, the Inquisition, you know, even the current debate between conservative and liberal theology and interpretations, all of that speak to a divide in the Christian church. It's sad but true, but it can be said that Christians do not have a good track record of displaying unity in the public realm. But, and here's the big but, if we dig a little deeper on what it really means, what Jesus really means about experiencing oneness and being in unity in God and in disciples and so on, it may not seem as far-fetched as it may first seem. First of all, and this is really an important concept, unity does not mean uniformity. Unity doesn't mean seeing eye to eye on all matters under the sun, or embracing the same opinions or fashions or musical preferences or culinary preferences, or agreeing on every political issue or doctrinal statement or creed. Doesn't mean uniformity in theological stance on baptism, on Holy Communion, on church ecclesiology, or on any matter of faith. It doesn't mean uniformity. In fact, if you think about it, uniformity on every level is almost an impossibility, an unreal scenario, since the world God created is already so full of variety and diversity to begin with. God seems to enjoy variety. God created a world with infinite variety and diversity, from the seemingly endless biological variations in flowers and trees and animals and birds, to the multitude of different languages and histories and cultures and tribes and musical and culinary preferences of human beings. God seems to really like variety. And so why shouldn't we? Rather than some kind of unreal uniformity or homogeneity for which we need to strive to achieve, this unity that Jesus speaks about is already here, is already there, deep down in the recesses of our hearts and minds and souls, something for which we need to awaken, something we need to recognize, something we at times indeed intuit or sense in the gut if we're paying attention. It's a unity that is known at the deep level of awe and wonder, that space of spaciousness that I talked about last week, that place of spaciousness where there's a sense of empathy and connection with all living beings and humanity, that place of mutual care and self-giving love and connection between ourselves and others. It is, in fact, a unity of love, love of God, love of others, that deep connection. I was reminded of this kind of unity when I read about the true story of Lou. Lou was a member of a church in the deep south of the United States. He was Hawaiian by birth. He was a devout Christian, a sincere person of faith. And Lou lived with leprosy, that debilitating disease of leprosy. It had gotten to the point of Lou's eyebrows and eyelashes disappearing. His paralyzed eyelids were causing tears to overflow constantly as if he were crying. He became almost totally blind because of the failure of a few nerve cells on the surface of his eyes. Lou was struggling constantly with his growing sense of fear and isolation from the world. His sense of touch, which was quickly fading, and that, combined with his near blindness, made him more and more afraid and withdrawn with every passing day. He most feared his eventual loss of hearing because his love of life was music. He loved music, and He feared the day that he would eventually lose his sense of hearing. In the church worship service of which he was a part, Lou happily contributed musically, robustly singing the hymns as the congregation sang. And as he was singing the hymns, he'd be playing his auto harp. He knew how to play an auto harp. Lou loved it. The people loved it. His therapist designed even a special glove that permitted Lou to continue playing his auto harp without further damaging his diseased hand. But there's one thing about Lou. Here it is. As members of that congregation have attested to, Lou was an integral part of that church, a valued, beloved person in that faith community. As one member put it, no one contributed more to the spiritual life of our church than Lou playing his auto harp. The member went on to say, when Lou dies, he will create a void in our church that no one else can fill. Not even a professional harpist with nimble fingers and a degree from the Juilliard School of Music. This is the kind of unity that Jesus was praying for so long ago, a deep connective unity, an unbreakable connection of love and care and affection felt at that deep gut level, that heart level. It's tough to put into words or describe with any amount of accurate articulation, but which is no less real, no less powerful and impactful. You know, members of churches, each of us can hold different political opinions, can have different preferences for music, for food, for fashion. We can each be very different in terms of our experiences, our histories, our cultural, ethnic backgrounds. All of that is okay. In fact, we need each other's differences, not only to experience the fullness of life that God has given us, and not only to learn from each other, but in order to reflect the body of Christ, what God initially intends, that the different but mutually interdependent parts of that body of Christ, of which Christ is the head. In 1 Corinthians, we read about this image of the church as being a body of Christ. Each part of that body, each member of that body brings their own gifts and unique gifts for the love and the sake of the world. And they all hold together. An unbreakable connection. No matter their differences, they still hold together that unbreakable connection to one another and to God in Christ, whose love binds us together. May God give us an ever deeper sense of that unity of love, we pray. I invite you to join Patty and I as we sing with Dawn on the piano. We sing together Deep in Our Hearts, an Inshallah piece out of the Sing the Circle Wide book number 1. Deep in our hearts there is a common vision. Deep in our hearts, there is a common song. Deep in our hearts, there is a common story, telling creation that we are one. Deep in our hearts, there is a common. Justice and peace in harmony. Deep in our hearts, there is a common longing. Deep in our hearts, there is a common theme. Deep in our hearts, there is a common flowing.
flowing to freedom like a stream. Deep in our hearts, there is a common vision. Deep in our hearts, there is a common song. Deep in our hearts, there is a common story telling creation that we
Let us pray. God of glory, we praise you for your presence in our lives and for all goodness that you shower upon your children in Jesus Christ. Especially we thank you for promises kept and hope for tomorrow, the enjoyment of friends, the wonders of your creation, love from our parents, our sisters and brothers, our spouses and children, the pleasures of living. God of grace, we are one with all your people, for we are sisters and brothers of Jesus Christ, and we offer our prayers for all whom we love. Especially we pray for the family and friends of Bob Henkel as they mourn his earthly death and as we all rejoice in his eternal life with you. Wrap them all in your comfort and in your courage. Pray for all those experiencing mental anguish of any kind during this pandemic lockdown. Open us all to the healing wonder and awe of your creation during spring and approaching summer. We pray for the Roman Catholic, the Anglican, the Lutheran, the United, the Mennonite, the Presbyterian, the Orthodox, and all other churches in the worldwide Christian communion. Great God, you are one God, and you bring together what is scattered and mend what is broken. Unite us with the scattered peoples of the earth, that we may be one family of your people. Bind up all our wounds and heal us in spirit, that we may be renewed as disciples of Jesus Christ, our Master and our Savior. Amen.
Amen.
Gathered into one by the Holy Spirit, let us pray as Jesus taught his disciples in whichever language or version you prefer. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name.
Your kingdom come,
your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us today our daily bread, and forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from the time of trial, and deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours,
now and forever. Amen.
The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face to shine on you and be gracious to you. The Lord look upon you with favor and give you peace. Amen. We sing together, You Are Mine, number 581.
You will hear my voice,
I claim you as my choice. Be still and know I am here.
I am hope for all who are hopeless. I am eyes for all who long to see. In the shadows of the night, I will be your light. Come and rest in me.
Do not be afraid, I am with you. I have called you each by name. Come and follow me.
Strength for all the despairing, healing for the ones who dwell in shame. All the blind will see, the lame will all run free, and all will know my name. Do not be afraid, I am with you. I have called you each by name. Come and follow me, I will bring you home. I love you and you are mine.
I am the word that leads all to freedom.
I am the peace the world cannot give. I will call your name, embracing all your pain.
Stand up now, walk and live.
Do not be afraid, I am with you. I have called you each by name. Come and follow me, I will bring.